On January 2nd, 1939, Time magazine made Hitler Man of the Year for 1938. This was barely 2 months after the National Socialists had smashed up Jewish businesses, burnt their synagogues, and sent tens of thousands to the concentration camps during Kristallnacht. So, from our point of view, making Hitler Man of the same year that Kristallnacht happened might seem a bit odd. And several passages in this Time magazine may surprise or even shock you, because what it says is probably not what you'd expect. We'll get to that. But actually, from the point of view of someone in 1938, what Time was writing about would have made perfect sense. Now, there's actually a few reasons why they made Hitler Man of the Year, not just one, but probably the main reason that is often stated is given in the first paragraph of the article itself. "Greatest single news event of 1938 took place on September 29th when four statesmen met at the Führer House in Munich to redraw the map of Europe. The three visiting statesmen at that historic conference were Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain of Great Britain, Premier Edouard Daladier of France, and dictator Benito Mussolini of Italy. But by all odds, the dominating figure at Munich was the German host, Adolf Hitler."
20 years earlier, the Great War had ended. Millions had perished in pointless trench warfare, and hardly anyone in the English-speaking world wanted another slaughter. So, during the Munich crisis, Hitler was threatening war over Czechoslovakia. The British especially wanted to avoid that war, and the world waited with bated breath, hoping that another catastrophe could be avoided.
"Führer of the German people, Commander-in-Chief of the German Army, Navy and Air Force, Chancellor of the Third Reich, Herr Hitler reaped on that day at Munich the harvest of an audacious, defiant, ruthless foreign policy he had pursued for 5.5 years. He had torn the Treaty of Versailles to shreds, he had rearmed Germany to the teeth, or as close to the teeth as he was able, he had stolen Austria before the eyes of a horrified and apparently impotent world. All these events were shocking to nations which had defeated Germany on the battlefield only 20 years before, but nothing so terrified the world as the ruthless, methodical, Nazi-directed events which during late summer and early autumn threatened a world war over Czechoslovakia. When, without loss of blood, he reduced Czechoslovakia to a German puppet state, forced a drastic revision of Europe's defensive alliances, and won a free hand for himself in Eastern Europe by getting a hands-off promise from powerful Britain and later France, Adolf Hitler, without doubt, became 1938's Man of the Year."
The Western world gave a sigh of relief. Another pointless war was avoided. That's why Hitler became Man of the Year. And from the Western perspective, it really would have been a pointless war. George Orwell wrote this a few days after the Time article.
"I wonder if the political situation will hold up. It's getting harder and harder for the English public. I suppose 50% of them knew whereabouts Austria was, and about 20% knew where Czechoslovakia was. But where is Ukraine? And where are Memel and Upper Malmedy? Not to mention Russian Subcarpathia."
The reality is that British boys and girls would have been dying for countries or provinces none of them had even heard of a few months prior. And obviously many of them didn't want that, so there was relief that war was averted. At least for the majority. But as the Time article shows, not everyone was happy.
"Most other world figures of 1938 faded in importance as the year drew to a close. Prime Minister Chamberlain's peace with honour seemed more than ever to have achieved neither. An increasing number of Britons ridiculed his appease the dictator's policy, believed that nothing save abject surrender could satisfy the dictator's ambitions. Among many Frenchmen there rose a feeling that Premier Daladier, by a few strokes of the pen at Munich, had turned France into a second-rate power, aping Mussolini in his gestures and copying triumphant Hitler's shouting complex. The once liberal Daladier at year's end was reduced to using parliamentary tricks to keep his job."
The Western leaders were humbled, and while there was a runner-up to the Man of the Year award, it wasn't any of them. No, Time favoured someone else, and this may be the first of many shocks to you.
"If Francisco Franco had won the Spanish Civil War after his great spring drive, he might well have been Man of the Year timber."
So if Hitler, the National Socialist, hadn't won Man of the Year, fascist Franco would have won it instead. And this shows that the excuse that Hitler only won it because he had prevented war is in fact questionable. If Franco had been made Man of the Year, what would have been the reason why? Franco didn't prevent a war, he was waging one. So it turns out that there were other reasons why Time picked Hitler as Man of the Year that have nothing to do with Munich.
But the figure of Adolf Hitler strode over a cringing Europe with all the swagger of a conqueror. Not the mere fact that the Führer brought 10,500,000 more people, 7 million Austrians, 3,500,000 Sudetans under his absolute rule made him the man of 1938. Japan, during the same time, added tens of millions of Chinese to her empire. More significant was the fact Hitler became, in 1938, the greatest threatening force that the democratic, freedom-loving world faces today.
Oh, so it wasn't because he had prevented war, it was because he was the biggest threat to the Western democracies. Wow, Time magazine really likes strong independent men who do not need no woman.
His shadow fell far beyond Germany's frontiers. Small neighbouring states, Denmark, Norway, Czechoslovakia, Lithuania, the Balkans, Luxembourg, the Netherlands, feared to offend him. In France, Nazi pressure was in part responsible for some of the post-Munich anti-democratic decrees. Fascism had intervened openly in Spain, had fostered a revolt in Brazil, was covertly aiding revolutionary movements in Romania, Hungary, Poland, Lithuania. In Finland, a foreign minister had to resign under Nazi pressure. Throughout Eastern Europe, after Munich, the trend was towards less freedom, more dictatorship.
Wow. I mean, what a great reason to make someone Man of the Year. Time is loving the fact that freedom is being destroyed and dictators are on the rise. And slightly before this, you can almost hear the dripping tears as Time laments Roosevelt's setbacks.
On the American scene, 1938 was no one man's year. Certainly it was not Franklin Roosevelt's. His purge was beaten and his party lost much of its bulge in the Congress.
So Roosevelt wasn't as strong a dictator as Hitler was. Therefore, Roosevelt doesn't get Man of the Year. And for context, many at the time believed that Roosevelt was following in the other dictators' footsteps.
We need to remember that businessmen in the 1930s had plenty of images of strong leaders around the world, Stalin, Mussolini, and Hitler to name a few. And it did not seem beyond possibility at the time that Roosevelt, with the many leftist New Dealers in the administration, might bring socialism to the United States. When his revolutionary programs were declared unconstitutional in 1935, Roosevelt famously threatened to pack the Supreme Court, a shocking move that made even some of his most stalwart supporters begin to waver. His fiery campaign rhetoric made it clear that Roosevelt was against businessmen, blaming them for the economic slump, and considered their subordination a key aim. Finally, regarding the now humorous worries of dictatorship, the reader should recall that every previous president in American history, except Ulysses S. Grant, had followed George Washington's example by not seeking a third term. Roosevelt was the first and only president to serve more than two terms, and only his death removed him from office.
Time is upset that Roosevelt wasn't as strong as Hitler. That's why he didn't win the Man of the Year award. So this is the first shocking element, but here's perhaps another.
The fashion turn. With Hitler in the driver's seat, with Mussolini, Franco and the Japanese military cabal riding behind, emerged in 1938 as an international revolutionary movement. Rant as he might against the machinations of international communism and international Jewry, or rave as he would that he was just a pan-German trying to get all the Germans back in one nation, Führer Hitler had himself become the world's number one international revolutionist. So much so that if the oft-predicted struggle between fascism and communism now takes place, it will be only because two revolutionist dictators, Hitler and Stalin, are too big to let each other live in the same world.
There are several things here, so let's unpack one at a time. First, in 1938, it had already been established that National Socialism was part of the fascist movement, even though Mussolini had been against Hitler up until 1936. In August 1933, Mussolini had made an agreement with Dollfuss and had turned Austria into a fascist state.
Dollfuss had already banned the Communist Party, and in June 1933, he banned the Nazi Party. Just think about that. If fascism and Nazism were the same movement, why did Dollfuss ban the Nazis? Clearly, they're not the same movement. Unlike Britain and France, Mussolini was determined to guarantee Austrian independence and stand up to Hitler. This is hardly surprising, given that, unlike Britain and France, Italy shared a border with Austria. Furthermore, in Mein Kampf, Hitler had said that he wanted not only Austria, but also the German-speaking Alto Adige in the Italian Tyrol, which the Italians had got under the Treaty of Versailles from the Austrians.
There was a coup in July 1934, and Dollfuss was mortally wounded. Fearing a German takeover of Austria, Mussolini sent Italian troops to the Austrian border, and Hitler, at this stage still having a small military, had to back down. So Mussolini saved Austria from an Anschluss in 1934, showing that fascism and National Socialism were not the same thing, and I've done a video on this. Hitler then sent arms to the Ethiopians during the Second Italo-Ethiopian War of 1935-36, wanting Italy bogged down in the fighting and Mussolini isolated on the international level. In such circumstances, Mussolini would be less able to protect Austria, which obviously worked out very well, as Mussolini was isolated and started moving towards the other person in Europe that was also isolated, Hitler. Hitler then invaded Austria in March 1938, and Mussolini did nothing to stop him. The Pact of Steel was also announced, and the Munich Agreement happened. So originally, Mussolini and Hitler had been enemies, but by January 1939, when Time magazine was writing its article on Hitler, Mussolini and Hitler had moved together, and thus National Socialism and Fascism had become linked. That's why Time reflects that by saying Hitler was part of the fashion turn. And even though Hitler called it National Socialism, in reality, Time is correct to point out that it was an international movement. Hitler didn't care about the national sovereignty of Austria or Czechoslovakia or any of the other countries he annexed or invaded. The guy eventually took over most of Europe and was looking to settle the lands of the East. Clearly, that's not a national movement. What's the difference between what Hitler was doing and what Lenin tried to do with his world revolution? Nothing. They were both invading other countries because these were international movements. The only difference was that Hitler was honest about his anti-Semitism. And that's why Time calls Hitler the world's number one international revolutionist. Because unlike the Soviets, he was successfully exporting his revolution. It's also why Time calls both Hitler and Stalin revolutionist dictators. They are the same, they're both international socialists, but both are in competition with each other. Time magazine was able to recognise that in 1938, and it's certainly not the only source to do that. Many knew this at the time. But the narrative then changed, and we'll get to hear why a little later.
But Führer Hitler does not regard himself as a revolutionary. He has become so only by force of circumstances. This is wrong. Hitler did regard himself as a revolutionary. Speaking to the SA in July 1922, Hitler said that the task of the movement was one day to revolutionarily restructure Germany from the ground up. To the frequently levelled accusations by the left that he was a reactionary, Hitler's reply was that the National Socialists intended a revolution, and elsewhere he spoke of the German-Germanic Revolution. In a speech on the 15th of January 1923, Hitler declared that the National Socialists were preparing a much greater revolution than the one of 1918. He defined this German revolution as the first step towards creating a state based on a specific Weltanschauung. In the months preceding the 1923 November Putsch, which Hitler defined as an attempt at a national revolution, he expounded the revolutionary claim of the NSDAP. "What Germany needs is a revolution, not reform," he said in August 1923 in an interview with The World, New York. So Time was wrong there, but it was corrected elsewhere. A generation ago, Western civilization had apparently outgrown the major evils of barbarism except for war between nations. The Russian Communist Revolution promoted the evil of class war. Hitler topped it by another, race war. Fascism and communism both resurrected religious war. These multiple forms of barbarism give shape in 1938 to an issue over which men may again, perhaps soon, shed blood. The issue of civilized liberty versus barbaric authoritarianism.
Let's just state that bit again. Both fascism and communism resurrected religious war. Time correctly identified that these were religious movements. Now, it may not have understood what type of religion it was, but it recognized the religious core of these ideologies. And it goes on to talk about the opposition to this religion from the other religious leaders at the time.
In religion, the two outstanding figures of 1938 were in sharp contrast, save for their opposition to Adolf Hitler. One of them, Pope Pius XI, 81, spoke with bitter sadness of Italy's anti-Semitic laws, the harrying of Italian Catholic action groups, the reception Mussolini gave Hitler last May, declared sadly, "We have offered our now old life for the peace and prosperity of peoples. We offer it anew. By spending most of the year in a concentration camp, Protestant pastor Martin Niemöller gave courageous witness to his faith. Out of Germany has come a steady, ever-swelling stream of refugees, Jews and Gentiles, liberals and conservatives, Catholics as well as Protestants, who could stand Nazism no longer."
It has since become popular to denounce National Socialism as a Christian movement. Many say that Hitler was either a Catholic or a Protestant. Yet, the evidence at the time, and during the war, made it clear that the conventional Christian faith was not at all in league with Hitler. There was a German Christian movement within Germany that aligned itself with National Socialism, trying to bridge the gap between the anti-Semitism of National Socialism and some obscure Jewish guy who died on the cross. You may not have heard of him, but Richard Carrier refers to him as the Jesus. It turns out that the Jesus was Jewish, which could be a somewhat inconvenient fact when your movement is fundamentally anti-Jewish.
If Jewishness was a religious force, then Christianity, an outgrowth of Judaism, was implicated through that relationship to the enemy. The connection between Christianity and Judaism provided an inexhaustible store of ammunition for attacks on the churches by Nazi theorists and neo-pagans. They sneered publicly at Christianity as nothing but diluted Judaism. Their derision egged on the German Christians' offensive against Jewish elements in their religious tradition, while putting them on the defensive against the very Nazi worldview they embraced.
So, to clarify, the Nazis hated the Jews, but also mainstream Christianity, since this was correctly seen as an offshoot of Judaism. Christians from both the Catholic and Protestant churches argued back against Nazism, but many were silenced or put in the camps. However, the German Christian movement, which was a new sect within Germany, wanted to bridge the ideological gap between Nazism and Christianity, resulting in this weird dynamic whereby the German Christians hated the Jews, even though Jesus was Jewish, and they were hated by the Nazis, even though they tried to be Nazis. So, it's a very odd situation, and it's no wonder that many don't fully grasp what was going on and see Nazism as a Christian movement. However, it's not just a mistake that this narrative of Hitler being pro-Christian was adopted. It was deliberate, and I'm going to show you that shortly. But first, let's continue with the Time article.
Unemployment was solved by 1. A far-reaching program of public works, 2. An intense rearmament program, including a huge standing army, 3. Enforced labour in the service of the state, the German Labour Corps, 4. Putting political enemies and Jewish, communist and socialist job holders in concentration camps. What Adolf Hitler and co. did to Germany in less than 6 years was applauded wildly and ecstatically by most Germans. He lifted the nation from post-war defeatism. Under the swastika, Germany was unified. His was no ordinary dictatorship, but rather one of great energy and magnificent planning. The socialist part of National Socialism might be scoffed at by hard and fast Marxists, but the Nazi movement nevertheless had a mass basis. the 1,500 miles of magnificent highways built, schemes for cheap cars and simple workers' benefits, grandiose plans for rebuilding German cities made Germans burst with pride. Germans might eat many substitute foods or wear ersatz clothes, but they did eat.
Yes, this is yet another primary source document stating what everybody knew at the time, that National Socialism was socialist. The magnificent planning, and the magnificent highways, and the magnificent substitute food was all done for the workers' benefit. Gunter Reimann's The Vampire Economy, another primary source from this era, gives us plenty of real-life examples of the socialism happening inside the Reich. Hitler's Beneficiaries shows us that it was the ordinary Germans who profited from National Socialism. And we have so much evidence of the socialism of National Socialism that the evidence truly is overwhelming. Yet even though people knew this in the 1930s, the narrative changed. And the question is, why? Why did it change? Well, one of the clues is in this Time article. Hard and fast Marxists scoff at the idea that National Socialism was socialism, because nothing is real socialism in their eyes unless there's bunny rabbits and rainbows. But why did everybody fall for this narrative? If people knew what the deal was back in the 1930s, then what caused the huge change in that point of view? Why do we suddenly go from correctly seeing National Socialism as pro-socialist, anti-Christian, and the land of poets and thinkers, to anti-socialist, pro-Christian, and the land of techno-Vikings? Well, there's a really big reason as to why this change in perception happened. And since most of you have never heard of the Jesus, I don't expect you to have heard of this little thing called Zavor. You see, socialists are against traditional religion, they're pro-central control of the economy, and they're pro-eugenics. You know, they're for a new Soviet man, or a new Aryan man, or a new Gnostic man. And since Hitler and Mussolini were now the enemy, they must stand for the opposite of what we stand for. So they must be for traditional religion. I mean, the Catholic Church is headquartered in Rome where Mussolini is, so the Pope must be on their side, even if he isn't. They must be pro-capitalist rather than central control of the economy, because the latter is what we're for. And since we're now allied with the Soviet Union, who is fighting Hitler too, that means that socialism and communism are good. Well, if they're good and Nazism is bad, that must mean that Nazism is capitalism, and even though the Western world was pro-eugenics and many of the eugenics policies of the Third Reich were being implemented in the West, and even though the West continued to be pro-eugenics right up and into the 21st century, the Western world must also pretend to be the good guys who didn't do anything wrong.
All these characterizations of National Socialism were largely smudged and clouded in the subsequent 50 years of journalism. National Socialism was divested of its socialist underpinning and erroneously posed as the flip side of communism, even though any contemporary understood National Socialism to be Bolshevism's fraternal twin. The secularist antipathy towards the Catholic Church engendered many works which framed the Church as collaborating with Hitler, even though anyone during the era would have recognized the Church as the most persistent and consistent enemy of the Third Reich's policies. Most notably, fascism and National Socialism were bundled into one movement, despite the fact that fascist Spain and Italy did more to rescue Jews from Hitler than did the Roosevelt administration. All of this was the consequence of the fog of war, which was only extended and intensified by the Cold War that immediately followed.
It is, in fact, Salmon's book which was the inspiration for this video, and he makes a solid argument that it was the propaganda of the war and the Cold War that followed it, plus the nationalized and politicized journalism we've had since that time, that shaped our understanding of these movements. In 1945, Eisenhower showed the pictures and videos of the Holocaust to the entire world, and yet, after the initial shock, the Holocaust was all but forgotten until the late 1970s. For decades, World War II historians stuck to tanks, helped by the fact that at least half the sources on the subject were locked behind the Iron Curtain. Nuclear war was more pressing, and with the tensions of the Cold War, the West needed Germany to be whitewashed of its crimes so it could be used as a bulwark against Soviet aggression. Thus, the idea of collective guilt was dropped, and the former enemies became best friends. Churchill didn't mention the Holocaust at all in his Second World War book, neither did Eisenhower or de Gaulle, and even Hollywood and our TV boxes completely ignored the topic, and it wasn't until the fall of the Soviet Union and the advent of the internet that interest in the Holocaust really got going. As Salmon makes clear, and there are books written on this very topic, scholarly interest in the Holocaust didn't get going until 40 years after the war. 40 years! And we're now going through a sort of boom in Holocaust literature. And this, in fact, helped the Holocaust denialists do their thing. And this all happened because of the political situation of the Second World War and the Cold War that followed it. The accurate perception of what National Socialism and Fascism was prior to the war was changed to fit the narrative that the establishment wanted you to think. During the war, they took over the media, and you know, it was nationalised, and it still is, follow the money. Then the West allied with the Soviet Union and adopted the Marxist narrative that National Socialism and Fascism were the end stages of capitalism, because that was convenient for the Western establishment, who were also looking to implement their own controls over the economy. The Second World War and the Cold War that followed it changed the narrative and distorted the truth about the nature of National Socialism, Fascism, Western democracy, and Marxism.
The tone and wording of the infamous Time article made it plain that Hitler and Stalin were considered two sides of the same coin. The only thing that would change this honest appraisal of communism was President Roosevelt's heavy-handed censure in quieting the press about Stalin when Roosevelt made him an ally.
The point of today's video is to get you to understand that when we look back at history through the lenses we wear in the present, we're not necessarily seeing things the way they truly were back in the day. History does not stand still, and our perception is distorted by narratives and events that came during or after the period we're studying. Therefore, it's up to us to recognize this bias, do our best to purge ourselves of our modern narratives, and take ourselves back to the time we're studying to see what the world was actually like. The reason Hitler was made Man of the Year in 1938 was for the same reason Stalin was made Man of the Year in 1939, the same year that he all but allied with the National Socialists and carved up Poland. Back in the 1930s and 40s, the old ideas of liberty and freedom were dying, and so we were looking for strong men to take the reins and lead us to a better future. We were abandoning laissez-faire and embracing economic controls, abandoning gold standards and calling for strong welfare states and militaries that someone else can pay for. We were casting off the old ideas of merit and responsibility, instead looking for equality, which necessitates the destruction of all those who are not equal. No longer did we believe in the old religions or individualism. Only new superstitions and a twisted science that invented mass sterilization, euthanasia, and nuclear bombs. And so, those leaders that stood for these new ideas were the dictators people looked up to. I know it's fiction, but this is what George Orwell was warning us about in his novels Animal Farm in 1984. The idea of giving up our freedoms in order to help each other might sound nice, but these ideas lead to totalitarianism. And you can see this in the popular film about Oppenheimer. He's trying to bring his political communism into the universities and the military, and the guys who believe in freedom and liberty are not happy with him. We've had tyrants and serfdom for millennia. Freedom and liberty are new ideas. Yet they were being abandoned during this era, in the name of something new, even though it wasn't new at all. Now, I did want to include a talk that was more in-depth about eugenics, but it's looking like I need to do a series on that because it's a big topic. I've been reading Salmon's book on the subject, and while I've not yet finished the book, it's a very enlightening read and was the inspiration for this video, so I do think you guys should pick it up. It's definitely put the pieces of the puzzle together for me, but one of the good things he does is show you how the narrative was twisted to suit the political agendas at the time, and if you are aware of these changes, you can compensate for them in the future. So yeah, I do say check it out. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.